A very good morning, dear students. In our previous session, what we have studied is we have studied about the pointers and string concepts, and pointers and functions. In that, some three different categories, that is pass by value, second one pass by reference, and third one pass by pointers. Along with the programming examples, we have discussed in the previous video. Now in today's session, we are going to continue the new topic, that is a memory allocation of pointers. Okay, so in computer, every data and instruction must be loaded into internal memory for processing. In order to process the instructions, those instructions will be present in the inside the computer memory. So those all instructions will be stored based on their data type. Some for integer, it will be allotted for 2 bytes. For float, it will be allotted for 4 bytes. And character 1 bytes and long 4 bytes. And double data type allocates 8 bytes. That is, a sufficient memory must be allocated for every data and instructions. That is what I said. If you want to allocate so and so variable, so if you define the variables as integer, means 2 bytes for each variable will be allotted or reserved inside the computer memory. If you declare the variables belongs to float, means it will be allocating each variable of 4 bytes. Similarly for character, long and double, based on the data type, it is going to allocate or reserve a certain memory blocks inside the computer. Okay, so sufficient memory must be allocated for every data and instructions. There are two types of memory allocation. This is most important. Two different types of memory allocation. The first one is a static allocation of memory, and second one is dynamic allocation of memory. See the term static. Static means that is a fixed. Okay, you cannot change whatever you have allotted the for a particular variables, that cannot be changed. The term is called as a static. Dynamic means you can change. Right, this is fixed and this can be changed. Okay, now we'll go with the first method, that is static allocation of memory. Static allocation of memory allocates, the static memory allocation refers to the process of allocating memory. This is also one type of allocation of memory during the compilation of the program. This is most important. Static allocation of memory will be allotted at the time of a compilation time. That is what static memory allocation refers to, the process of allocating memory during the compilation of the program. That is why I just changed the text color and I just underlined the terms during the compilation of the program. That is before the program is executed. Generally, a more space is reserved to prevent the memory problems. The unused space cannot be reused here, especially in static allocation of memory. Whatever you allocate, for example, int a of 100, this is what your declaration, int a of 100. That means you are using a one-dimensional array in the example. So you're making use of the location from a of 0 to a of 99. But in that, you are using only the first 10 locations, the first a of 0 to a of 9. The rest of things are still, it is empty. But that particular memory cannot be reused. That is what they are saying. The unused space cannot be reused. Therefore, there may be a waste of memory problems, especially in a static allocation of memory. Okay, so have a look at the example. Int a, they have declared a one variable that is of type a, that is a, that a is of type integer data type. In the comment line, what they have just written, allocates how many bytes? 2 bytes. As I said in the beginning, it's based on the data type. If we choose integer, means 2 bytes will be allotted. If we choose float, means it is going to allocate 4 bytes. If I choose the double, it is going to allocate how many bytes? 8 bytes. Allocates 2 bytes of memory space during the compilation time. You need to remember, static memory allocation refers to the process of allocating memory at the time of, during the compilation of the program. Okay, it is a fixed, it cannot be changed. On the other hand, The second method is called as a dynamic allocation of memory. So dynamic memory allocation refers to the process of allocating memory during the execution. That is why I just changed the color of the text and it just underlined those three words. Static allocation at the time of during the compilation, dynamic allocation during the execution of the program, or else you can call it as a runtime, at a runtime. Okay, so memory space allocated with this method is not fixed. You can just make changes. If you want more memory, you can allocate. If you want, you can reduce the memory, okay, by using two special operators called as new and delete operators. That is what comes in the next line. A C++ supports a dynamic allocation and a deallocation of objects using the two terms called as new and delete operators. Okay, so you need to concentrate the term static allocation and a dynamic allocation. The terms which I have underlined in static and as well as dynamic, the two terms are the most important. Static allocation at the time of during the compilation time, dynamic allocation during the execution, or else you can call it as a at the run time. Fine. So that allocation can be done with the help of a two beautiful operators called as a new and delete operator. These operators allocates memory up to object from a pool called as free store. From this particular free store, this is an area. From that area, the memory allocation can be done. So if you want to increase the size of memory, if you want to just increase the memory bytes, okay, that extra memory will be there in the free store. From that you can choose. Fine. Now we'll just move on to the next. That is what, new operator and a delete operator. We can allocate storage for a variable while program is running, that is what, executing, by using new operator. Using new operator, we can allocate storage, an extra amount of space, extra amount of bytes is allotted using the operator called as a new. That is what they have said, the first line. We can allocate storage for a variable while program is running by using the new operator. It is used to allocate memory without having to define variables and then make pointers point to them. No need of defining and all directly, okay? Without having to define variables and then make pointer to point to them. The following code demonstrates how to allocate memory for different variables. To allocate memory of type integer, have a look at these two lines. The first line, int star p number. Have a look at this, int star p number. As you all are familiar, this first line is represented, this first line is known as a declaration of what? Declaration of a pointer variable. Int is the data type, star is the asterisk mark, or indirection operator, or else pointer operator. And this p number, it's a continue, there is no blank space between p and number. Okay, it's complete one word. That means p number is a pointer variable of type integer type. The next line, what they are doing, p number is equals to new one space int. P number is a pointer variable is equals to new is a keyword. As I said, new and delete operator, using those two operator we can allocate and deallocate the memory. New of type, data type is integer. Have a look at this. In the above example, p number is a variable and new is a operator. This is what? New is a operator. That means it reserves a required number of bytes at a runtime. How much you want? Okay, for example, if you want 1 byte or if you want 2 bytes of memory at the time of runtime, that space will be created by this operator called as a new. A new operator, in bracket we wrote, reserves required number of bytes at a runtime. Close bracket here. Allocates how many bytes? 2 bytes of memory, and assigns that to the variable p number. That is what here, the second line, as integer value is given to variable that is stored in that address. The first line, this first line declares the pointer P number, and the second line then allocates memory for an integer and then makes P number point to the this new memory. This is how they are going to use this new operator to allocate extra memory at the time of execution or runtime. Now we'll move on to the second operator, that is a delete operator. Okay, before going to say this, they will ask for 1 mark. What do you mean by new operator and what do you mean by delete operator? They may expect for a 1 mark. The delete operator is used to destroy the variable space which has been created by using the new operator dynamically. Using the new operator, we can just create a space to store the data. And using the delete operator, we can just destroy the variable space which has been created by the using new operator dynamically. So using delete operator to free dynamic memory as delete one blank space IPTR. That means that memory will be reused by other programs or other data. So using this, we can allocate, and using this delete operator, we can reuse the same memory. This is about the new operator and as well as delete operator. Now we'll just have a look at the table. A difference between a static memory allocation and a dynamic memory allocation. This is expected for 3 marks. As I said in the chapter in the beginning, from this chapter, total of 4 marks. That 4 marks is divided into 2 parts. One question will be for 1 mark and one question will be for 3 marks. This table can be expected for 3 marks. I think has been asked in one of the question paper. Write the difference between a static and dynamic memory allocation. Now have a look at, there are two beautiful columns. The first one is static memory allocation and second one is dynamic memory allocation. Now we'll just read the one points in each side. The first one, which is marked with a green color, memory space is allocated before the execution of the program. That is what we have just now in the previous page we have mentioned the term called as during the compile time. Okay, memory space, static memory space is allocated before the execution of the program, or else you can bracket, you can mention as during the compile time. Memory space is allocated at the time of compilation time, or else you can mention before the execution of the program. Both are same. Now the first point in the second column, that is dynamic memory allocation. Memory space is allocated during the execution of the program. There, they are mentioned in the static before the execution. Here, during the execution of the program. Once again, memory space is allocated during the execution of the program. Now, second point in static memory allocation. Memory space allocated is fixed. Look at the term, fixed. As I said, while explaining the static memory allocation, the terms, before going to explain the static and dynamic, you just try to understand the general meaning behind the static and dynamic. Static means that is fixed, cannot be changed. Okay, dynamic means it can vary. You may increase or you may decrease. Memory space allocated is fixed. Here in the second column, that is dynamic memory allocation, memory space allocated is not fixed. You can increase, you can decrease. That is what we have done in a dynamic memory allocation. Using new operator, we can increase the memory bytes, we can increase the size. Okay, using delete operator, we can again reuse the same memory for the other programs. Now have a look at the third difference between a static and dynamic memory. Third one, more memory space is required, because once you allocate a memory, as I said, an example, int a of 100 means it is going to reserve 100 bytes from a of 0 to a of 99. That much of memory will be reserved for the variable called as a. Among that, I'm using only the first 6 or 5 this per block memory blocks. The rest of the memory blocks are empty. Those blocks are not used by other parts of the other programs. Okay, That means those memory blocks, 100 blocks will be reserved for that particular program. You cannot use, other programs cannot use that particular memory. That is why the third point, more memory space is required. Here, less memory space is required. How much we want, that much we can use in the dynamic memory allocation. Next, the last difference between the static and dynamic memory allocation, that is, memory allocation is from stack area. And the last point in the dynamic memory allocation is memory space from heap area. Okay, these are the four differences between static memory allocation and dynamic memory allocation. But you must be familiar with the minimum 3 points. Okay, this is expected for 3 marks. Got it? Now we'll just move on to the next. So, pre-store, in bracket, heap memory, pre-store. Just now we had come across stack and heap. Okay, memory allocation is from the for static, memory allocation is from stack, and for dynamic, this memory allocation is from heap. Pre-store, the term, see, pre-store means, pre-store is a pool of memory available to allocated and deallocated storage for the objects during the execution of the program. See, in the dynamic memory allocation at that time, we will take some particular blocks of memory from the pre-store and we used to allocate, and again using the delete operator, we used to again delete that particular memory, and the same memory will be reused by other programs. That means a pre-store. Pre-store is it's an open space memory. From that particular block, some amount of memory blocks will be taken, and again after completion of that, again it will come and store in that only. Using the operator new and delete, we will just make the memory from this. That is why it is called as a pre-store. Pre-store is a pool of memory available to, for which purpose it is available? To allocate and deallocate, that look at the term, to allocate and deallocated storage for the objects, especially during which time? During the execution of the program memory. That is what static at the time of compile, dynamic at the time of execution, or else you can call it as at the runtime. Right, now moving to the next segment, memory leak. If the objects that are allocated memory dynamically, I'll repeat once again, if the objects that are allocated memory dynamically are not deleted using delete, that means the memory which was allocated using the new operator using dynamically are not deleted, those memories still deleted so far, the memory blocks remains occupied even at the end of the program, such memory is called as a memory leak. The memory, some particular blocks are allotted or used using the dynamic memory allocation dynamically, are not deleted using delete, the memory blocks remains occupied even at the end of the program. After completion of program also, still those particular memory blocks are still they are using. Such memory is called as a memory leak. Okay, so such memory blocks are also are known as orphaned memory blocks. Orphaned memory blocks means no one is there for. That means you can find the dictionary meaning, and orphaned means no one is. It's in a single. Okay, these orphaned memory blocks, when increases in number, bring adverse effect on the system. Adverse means a very worse situation. These orphaned memory blocks, when increases in number, bring a worse effect on the system. This situation is called as a memory leak. Is expected for 1 mark. What do you mean by memory leak? If an object that are allocated memory dynamically are not deleted using delete operator, the memory block remains occupied even at the end of the program. Such memory is called as a memory leak, orphaned memory. Okay, now we'll move on to the next one. have a look at this, pointers and structures. As we all are familiar with the term called as structure in the last year, structure is a collection of heterogeneous data items under one common name. That means, which is a collection of some different data types. Let me tell you an example, general syntax of a structure declaration. Structure name, open flower bracket, data type member name one, data type member name two, dash, 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 data type n, member name n, semicolon, and close flower bracket and end with a semicolon. That was the general syntax to define a structure. Now, in that we will make use of the concept called as a pointer. We can create pointers to structure variables. Have a look at this, an example. Struct is a keyword. What is the name of structure? Student. Open flower bracket. Int rule number. Rule number is the data member of type integer type. P is a data member of type float. One is integer, another one is float. Close flower bracket, end with semicolon. See, student, one blank space, yes. Student is the name of structure. Yes is a structure variable. Student star sp. Student is a structure name. Star sp is a pointer, is equals to ampersand yes. That means this pointer object, student star sp is a pointer object, is holding the address of yes. Have a look at this line. Student is a structure name. Star sp is a pointer object, is holding the address of yes object. Star sp, see what we are doing here means I am trying to access the data member of a structure. I am trying to access, that is roll number. See, I cannot access directly. So for that purpose, I have to make use of the pointer. Star sp, that must be written in bracket. Dot, as we all know, dot is a member access operator to access the data member and as well as member function. Star sp within the bracket dot rule number is equals to 14. We are assigning a value to the data member. Okay, we cannot directly assign a value with the help of a star sp. Star sp is a pointer object structure. Star sp dot rule number is equals to 14. The above statement can be written using the operator as this arrow. Sp arrow rule number is equals to 14. This can be written as this. Both are same. Okay. Sp arrow rule number is equals to 14. How to represent this means an hyphen and a greater than symbol. First, you need to use a hyphen symbol and a greater than symbol. This is about the pointers and the structures. Now we'll move on to the next segment, pointers and object. The pointers pointing to objects are referred to as object pointers. I'll repeat once again. The pointers pointing to objects are referred to as object pointer. Declaration of a pointer to object. Have a look at this example, this syntax. Class name, one blank space, asterisk, object pointer. Class name, asterisk, object pointer. See, this is a syntax to create a pointer object. So far in the almost all program, what we have done, we used to create an object for the, we used to create a normal object. Maybe in the frequency program or inserting an element or maybe a deleting an element or binary search. Class name. Class name is a frequency, star. There we were not at all making use of the operator called as a star. So just we used to write frequency F. Frequency is a class name. F is an user defined object. There we were not at all having any kind of an operator. Okay, star and all. But here, look at this syntax. Class name, star, object pointer, and with semicolon. This line is an syntax of creating a object pointer. Here, class name is the name of the class. object pointer is the pointer to an object of this class type. Have a look at this example. Employee star EPTR. I'm missing semicolon here. Employee star EPTR. Employee is the name of the class. Star is a pointer. EPTR is a pointer object. Okay, need to understand this concept. Employee is a class name. Star EPTR. Star indicates you are creating a pointer object. You are not creating a normal object. You are creating a pointer object. That is why star EPTR. Employee is a class name. Got it? And end with an example. Now just have a look at an example here. A C++ program to demonstrate the use of pointer to object. Have a look at this programming example. This is a very simple programming example. After this, I will take you to the practical program that makes use of the concept of pointer to object. So have a look at this. The two header files, hash include within the angular bracket iostream.h, and second one, hash include within the angular bracket conio.h. Then comes the name of class. What is the name of class? Employee, open flower bracket, private. So I just declared some three data members here. Employee number of type integer, name of 20 of type character, salary of type float. Three data members were declared. Okay, so here the two member functions we have used, one is the read member function and another one is display member function. There is no computing at all. I'm just accepting employee number, employee name and employee salary, and the same thing I'm displaying with the display member function. But still I'm making use of the concept called as a pointer to object here. So coming back to this, every C++ program execution starts from which particular line? Void main function, open flower bracket. The next line, this line, you need to concentrate the first one and second line. These two are the most important line in this entire program. The first line, employee one blank space star EP, end with semicolon. Here it won't come comma. There is a slight mistake in this particular line. It won't come comma here. Employee is a name of class. Star EP is a pointer object. Okay. Once again, I'll repeat. Employee is a name of class. Star EP is a pointer object. Well, in the second line, EP is equals to employee one blank space E comma star EP. Okay. Once again, you concentrate this particular line. Here we are creating two objects. One is E, another one is EP. Employee is a name of class. There you have a one blank space here. This E is a normal object and star EP is a pointer object. Okay, need to concentrate here. While writing also, you must be very careful about this particular line. Employee is a name of class. E is a object, a normal object. Star EP is a pointer object. Well, move on to the second line. EP is equals to address E. That means EP is a pointer object. This pointer object is holding the address of which object? E object. This is most important. EP is equals to address E. That means EP is a pointer object. This pointer object is holding the address of which object? E object, that is this E. Okay. The next line, CLR is CR. If you want, you can use, otherwise not, it's not a compulsory. Next, what we are doing, I'm trying to access read member function and display member function. And so far in the before coming to this pointer and all, we have explained n number of programs, all practical programs, theoretical programs in classes and object, function overloading, constructors and all, inheritance. We used to, in order to access those member functions, we were making use of the dot operator. But here, I'm not at all making use of the dot operator. Instead of that, I'm using an arrow operator. See, have a look at this arrow. EP is a pointer object, arrow. How to use arrow? It's very simple. You need to use hyphen and a greater than symbol. Okay, first you need to use one hyphen, then a greater than symbol. EP is a pointer object, hyphen greater than read member function. Directly it will take you to the which member function? Read member function. Have a look at this. This is what the read member function. Void one blank space, read member function, open flower bracket. What we are doing, we are displaying a message called as enter employee number comma name and salary, double quotation close, stream stream insertion end L. I am going to display on output device, that is please enter the employee number, name and salary. You need to input three values. First employee number, next name of the employee, next salary of the employee. That is what we are accepting here. See in stream extraction, first we are accepting employee number, then we are accepting employee name, then last we are accepting salary of the employee, end with semicolon, close flower bracket. This read member function over again, it goes here ep arrow. Ep is a pointer object, arrow display member function. Again it directly comes to this particular line. Okay, void display, void is a return type specifier, display is a member function. Do we have any parameters inside this parenthesis? No arguments at all. Okay, open flower bracket. See what we are doing. I am displaying employee number first. In the first cout statement, cout stream insertion, double quotation start, employee number, okay, double quotation close, stream insertion. I am going to display here employee number, whatever the value which is given by the user, that will be displayed here. Okay, see out employee name. In the same line, first employee number, in the same line employee name. It won't come next line because I'm not at all using here backslash n. So it is going to print in the same line, first employee number, then employee name, then employee salary. Have a look at this, three different output statement. Last one, employee salary will print as it is, double quotation, stream insertion, salary. Whatever the value which is given by the user, that will be displayed on the output device in the same line. First number, employee number, then employee name, then employee salary. Close flower bracket. This close flower bracket indicates end of display member function, and this close flower bracket indicate end of class. The two member functions were declared and defined inside the class. There you won't see scope resolution operator in this program. It comes here, get member function and close. That means end of C++ program. Have a look at here, and there is a note regarding this program. Here employee is an already defined class. Okay, as we all know that employee is a name of class. When accessing members of the class, an object pointer, the arrow operator is used instead of a dot operator. What they are saying, in order to access the data member or in order to access the member function, before that we were using the dot operator, but here in this program, the pointer concept, we are making use of the arrow operator. So as I said earlier, how to write arrow operator in a computer means hyphen and a greater than symbol. Got it? This is just an example of pointer to object. Okay, now we'll move on to the next program. So program number 12, this is a practical program. Oh, got it? Practical program to create a class containing the following data members. First one, it should have a register number, name and fees of a student, and also create a member function to read and display the data using the concept of pointer to object. This is also almost same program. Here I am just taking the data members as register number, name, fees. Okay, there it was in the previous program, employee number, name and salary. The same thing there also, we have not at all done any kind of a calculation, but in this program also I'm not doing any kind of a calculation. I'm just accepting register number, name and fees of a student. The same thing will print on the output device using the concept of pointer to object. Have a look at this program. Two header files, hash include iostream.h and hash include conio.h. okay, then comes that, what is the name of class? Class name is student. So open flower bracket, private, some one, three data members. Register number is a data member of type long. Okay, regularly we used to give the data type as integer. Here I just changed the data type as long. That means register number may be a too large, which may be a 6 digit or 7 digit or okay. So for that purpose, we are using the data type as long. The range of integer is only -32,768 to +32,768. If the integer, if the register number is more than that, means at that time we should go for the data type as long. Then next, character name of 20 to store the name of a student, float face. Okay, these three data members are declared under the access specifier called as private. Now public, how many member functions are there? Two member functions. One read data, another one is display. These two member functions are declared inside the class and they are going to define outside the class. That is say, there you can see here the, what is this? A scope resolution operator. Why do we use scope resolution operator? It is used to define member function outside the class, right? Now, so every C and C++ program execution starts from which particular line? Void main function. Open flower bracket. Student is the name of class. S comma star SP. That means, as I said, the same in the previous program, there also we have created two beautiful objects. One is normal object, another one is pointer object. S is a normal object here in this program and star SP is a pointer object. Have a look at this command line. Create a pointer to point student object. Create a pointer object to point to student object. CLR, SCR if you want, you can use, okay? So next line, SP is equal to address S. SP is a pointer object, is holding the address of which object? S object, okay? Now, S, okay? S arrow, not as 1 minute. Here it must be SP, okay? SP arrow read data. Here it must be SP arrow read data. That means directly it will go take you to the read data member function. Void student. Void is the return type specifier. Student is a name of class. Colon. These two colons are called as a scope resolution operator. Read data is a member function. What we are doing here is I am just accepting the register number of a student, name of a student, and fees of the student, okay, with the three different output statement. Okay, enter register number will accept the register number of a student, enter student name, so and so name will be stored in this name, and enter fees, for example, so and so fees for 10,000 fees is stored in this variable, Ravi is stored in name, and 101 is stored in this register number. After that, again it goes to this line. Before going to this, have a look at this. Access student data member using a pointer. Access student data member using a pointer. Here it must be SP. Got it? And there also, and the next line also SP. SP arrow display. Directly it goes to which member function? Here it goes to display member function. Void is the return type specifier. Student is the name of class. These two colons are called as scope resolution operator. Why do we use scope resolution operator? To define member function outside the class. Display is a member function. Do we have any arguments inside this parenthesis? No arguments at all. So what I am doing here is I am just printing in three different lines. The first I am printing register number will print as it is. Here I am going to print as 101. Cursor comes to the next line because of endl. Second line. See out stream insertion student name, double quotation close, stream insertion name. Okay, I'm going to print name as Ravi. Stream insertion endl, cursor comes to the next line because of endl. And the last see out statement, stream insertion within the double quotation, fees colon will print as it is, fees 10,000 will print here, cursor comes to the next line because of endl. And this closing flower bracket represent end of a display member function. At the end it comes here, get close flower bracket. This is a very simple program, this which demonstrate the use of pointer to object, right? Now just have a look at the output. Enter the register number. So and so number is given here, 243850. Enter the student name, Kirti. Enter the fees, 14050. This is how the output I'm going to get at the end. Register number is 243850. Student name, Kirti. Fees, 14050. This is about the chapter called as a pointer. Okay, that's all we have from the chapter pointers. Total marks weightage is 4. We'll be having two beautiful questions, 1 mark one question and 3 mark one question. In the next video we'll discuss the previous question papers. Okay, thank you for watching this video.